Today on the Perception in Action podcast, my interview with James Rudd from Liverpool John Moores University, an ecological dynamics approach to teaching movement skills in PE. So it's time for a call to action. Hi, everyone. This is Rob Gray from ASU and PerceptionAction.com. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, my interview with James Rudd. James has done some really interesting research looking at movement competency and physical literacy in children. He is currently in the middle of a very ambitious randomized control trial comparing linear and nonlinear approaches to PE. In the interview, we discuss the early findings from this work, what the trends are in this area, and the issue of what we should be assessing when teaching children these skills. Hope you enjoy. Today, my guest is James Rudd from Liverpool John Moores University. Thanks for taking some time to talk with me, James.
Absolute pleasure, Rob. It's brilliant to be on.
So to start with, can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got interested in this area?
Yeah, sure. So if we look at my academic kind of career, and I'm going to count my basketball coaching and kind of be involved in that, in that kind of learning journey, of which has led me to where I am, is during coaching from probably the age of 15 up to around about all through university. So I went to university University of Hull in England, and I did a sports science degree. And continuing kind of a basketball on the side, it helped pay for me through. Really enjoyed the degree, but then kind of finished and was like, no, I want to be a physical education teacher. That's where I want to go. I really want to kind of combine this, and that's a good career. So I went down to Southeast London, that's where I'm actually from, and got a really exciting job, because at the time for PE, there was a lot going on. So actually, it was just building up to the Olympic, we just won the Olympics, and there's an Olympic legacy bid to actually take people who are working in secondary school PE and put them to support the development of primary school PE. And that was really interesting. So I ended up working around, I think it was about 8 different primary schools for about 5 years, supporting them through their PE, developing their PE curriculum, and getting to work with this huge range of kids from the sort of Southeast London, as actually down the old Kent Road. So if you know the Monopoly board, around bit on the Monopoly board around there, I was working with these kids. And yeah, it was a lot of fun, and got to work with lots of different teachers who had a different styles and different ways of doing things. And yeah, I just found it a fascinating journey. And then just before the Olympics, the government cut that money, and I had the choice to go back into secondary school, but I was 26 or so at the time. I was like, no, tell you what, let's go and do a gap year. So I went off to Australia. Whilst in Australia, I just picked up some supply teaching and some coaching work, and actually bumped into one of my old university lecturers from Hull. That was Professor Remco Coleman, who was now a professor out there. And we got working together on a few bits and talking, and ended up submitting to do a PhD with him. And that was looking at movement skills and looking at what gymnastics adds to that within a PE curriculum. And a bit more of a motor development slant. So Dr. Lisa Barnett was involved in that as well. Professor Damien Farrow, who had him on my supervising team, which was a lot of fun. Dr. Jason Berry as well. And that was good, because I got to work alongside, or do my PhD alongside, like Tim Buzzard, mm-hmm. and a few of the other guys I've been on your show. And then after that, I was there for about 4.5 years, came back, and I picked up a senior lecturer position in physical education at Liverpool John Moores. And yeah, now I'm in the sports science department again, which is a really exciting place to be.
That's great. It sounds like you're what some people call a pracademic, right? You got lots of actual practical experience applying it, and the academic side, which is, I think, a great in this area.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah. No, I think it's really important. So what we've done, as you mentioned, what we want to focus on today is kind of PE, movement skills in children, those kind of issues. And I think everyone's aware of this kind of general problem and the issue, but you know, what is the research showing about kind of the trends in terms of kids developing movement competency, movement skills, and those kind of things?
Yeah, okay. So there's actually a really good body of research out there. A lot of researchers across the globe doing some trying to understand how well children are moving, these movement skills, how well developed they are in the population across different demographics as well. So I think what did my PhD is done the most research and looking at this more at a population level. Mm-hmm. So if you look at Australia, let's start with them. What we see in the state of New South Wales over the last 10, 15 years, they've assessed well over 15,000 children, looking cross-sectionally, looking at how children are, by the time they're finishing primary school, how good they are. Some really basic, what they call in Australia, and where you have these fundamental movement skills. It's basic throwing, catching, kicking, striking, jumping. So how well they can do this. And the idea is if you have the base of these foundations, this good fundamental base of these skills, you'll be able to go into play football. You'll be able to go into like a baseball. So this is the idea that the more developed these skills, if you've mastered these, you'll be able to pick up a range of sports. It's the idea kind of behind them. And what they're finding, though, is by the time children are leaving primary school, so they're finding much consistently that 50% of kids, under 50%, have actually mastered these basic skills, so not being able to do this. Mm-hmm. And actually, then you start to look at different groups or different cohorts in this. So you look at girls tend to score worse than boys and maybe more of the ball sports and the object control manipulation skills. And then a study I was involved in 2015 in Melbourne focused very much looking at, well, what other type of groups, do any other environmental factors start playing or influencing this? And we found that if you were English was your second language, so you're culturally linguistic or from a diverse background, and you're a girl, again, you're more significantly less likely to be performing well at these skills. So that's like an Australian snapshot. But as I said, like in the UK where I am now, there's been 5 or 6 studies done in the last 10 years, probably a few more, to be honest, now, when I last checked. But around good samples, around 250 children. And actually the latest one that's come out is what we see is in children about the age of 9, by Mike Duncan and the guys in Coventry, we're only seeing about 20% of children have mastered these basic skills. Yeah, and then there's research going on from various other parts of the country as well, which is showing similar. And we progressed to Ireland, again, have like really pulled up traction in this area, and again, are finding low levels of movement skills in the population. Studies, had a quick look, and I saw there's studies in Italy, Belgium, over in America, with the work of Ali Bryan, Jackie Goodway, David Stodden, showing these similar levels of like quite poor, low levels of movement skill in children. Countries we might not expect it as much. So like a Brazil, potentially very outside, culture outside. Again, certain areas, maybe these more deprived areas, we're seeing these low levels of movement skills. Same with South America and also Asian countries. So there's research now out there in China, Singapore, Hong Kong. And they're all telling us this kind of similar pattern that children don't have as well developed basic movement skills as we would like to expect. We often think children, oh, they're really active, they do, and over as they get older, they're going to develop these skills. What we're seeing is that's not the case.
Wow. Yeah, that's really interesting. And so you've some of the work you've looked at is kind of cross-sectional. You also, I think we were talking before, there's some longitudinal work that people have done in this area. Kind of what has that shown?
Yeah, now that's really interesting, Rob, because again, what we're seeing is, to be honest, a similar story in let's take, again, Australia have done a lot of work. And in Western Australia, what they've shown, over the last 30 plus years, really, they've assessed around 27,000 children, mm-hmm, looking at children's movement skills. And what they're finding is children who were tested back in the 1980s are actually had better movement skills and the children which are being tested today. Okay, so we're starting to see that there's change in society, changes, and obviously we're going through a huge change at the moment, but does have this potential impact on the way we're moving. And if we're moving less, we're being less active, then potentially this is going to have that consequence to our movement skills. A strength of this test, and there are some limitations which I'd like to come on, mm-hmm, a strength of this test is we're able to make these comparisons. And also, we were able to actually, I did a study back in 2015 from a colleague from Belgium. We both were in our final phase of our PhD, and we had similar data. And it was collecting the same very robust and reliable way on a similar demographic of children, age, and demographic. But we decided, well, let's look at how an Australian sample compared to a Belgian sample on this assessment to look at the movement. And we looked across and we found actually there were small differences, but they weren't very meaningful. We could see there were differences between the two cohorts, but they were around the same. But what was really interesting is because of these kind of how reliable these tests are. Now, there may be some issues with validity, which I reckon we should come on to, but how reliable they are is when we actually compared the data based on the 1974 sample, the normative data from 40 years, collected 40 years ago, the bell curve had shifted. So they were down that lower end as a whole group. None of our children were meeting in this excellent movement skills. They were kind of down the other end, which kind of shows that there is this shift based on the society we live in, that children are getting less opportunities to play and be active for various reasons. And that is having a non-cost to their development of their movement skills.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point. And yeah, I like that point that you're making. You know, I think the having really strict and consistent tests of catching and whatever is beneficial in one way because you can compare it easily. But yeah, I think I know where you're headed. It comes at a cost because we're probably looking more at for like an ideal technique and movement form than so much assessing skill, like allowing for adaptability individually, right? Is that some of the issue you see with these?
Yeah, it's a real challenge for the area. I think it's something more recently, and especially with the rise in your more contemporary theories, shall we say, these ecological dynamics and things, and this idea of adaptability and immersion, the importance of the environment, role the environment actually plays in how skills develop, that are we getting a true capturing children's, like, is fundamental movement skills the right word for a start? That would be one we could discuss, but I think just are we getting a true picture of their skill test. And we're definitely getting something. Like, the data is clear, it's showing us something, and it's important we listen to it. But as we're moving forward, do we actually keep doing this to a certain extent? But can we look at streamlining this or looking to look more at this more adaptive skill? I guess, and I came to that actually not from reading ecological dynamics, but from an experience I had out in working with the children journey, carrying out these tests. So as you say, you work into this optimal movement template across these skills. And one of the skills on the assessment battery, which is often used, is something called a gallop. Have you ever heard of a gallop, Rob?
It makes you think of a horse.
like a horse gallop, but as a kid doing it. And the idea of it being is a kind of a forward movement, but it's not quite a skip. So one leg always stays behind and you kind of, one leg's forward and the other leg comes up behind and you're kind of galloping along on 2 feet. And I don't think I've done justice in explaining it. The way the test works is I will say, right, Rob, can you stand on this line here? There's 20-minute space in front of you. What I want you to do is you're going to copy what I'm going to do, a gallop, and I will demonstrate to you the gallop. And I'll give you a practice and then I'll ask you to do it twice. And I will score those trials. So I'm going to look at like how rhythmic your movement was. Does one leg come up but doesn't overtake the other leg? Do your arms kind of move in this pendulum motion? So I'm looking for this kind of very template of a movement. And I remember this one girl, and she couldn't get it. She could not. And it's quite common, to be honest. They don't have a movement pattern. They can't get started. They can't do it. And I thought, no, don't worry. You did wonderful. Thank you very much. And we moved on. And actually, you know, it's 10 minutes later, it's break time. So I popped outside and I was watching this group playing on this kind of hill in their playground, on the grassy hill. And I'm watching, they're playing this game of like chase. And then she's chasing one of the other children and she starts running down this hill. And what pattern is perfectly from this is this gallop. Okay, if you're running down some stairs, this kind of gallop motion will emerge. So it made me start to really think about, well, actually, have I shortchanged that child potentially in some of her movement behavior? Now, it still gave a good roundabout figure of where she's at, I would say, but it did make me start questioning is, do some of these children skills need to be taught explicitly? Do I need to be using instructions, demonstration? And actually, from my very test kind of, it really isn't needed. So that was something I guess we are seeing now from these researchers who are doing research in this area to start questioning and looking at this and looking at technologies. Technology is one way to look at like more of an ecologically valid environment to let kids play in, and then can we kind of figure out what their movement patterns are within that. I've taken it, and I think I'll talk a bit later on, this idea of divergent movement. But so there's different ways now being explored or questions answered. So yeah, but it's an interesting one. It's not to take away from this research, which is done, because it's vitally important, but it does start us to question and then to start thinking about our teaching as well.
Yeah. I can. That's a really great story. I'd imagine I would be a similar. I have trouble when you can't tell me the function or purpose of what I'm doing. A lot of things in around life, I don't listen very well. So why am I galloping? But if you told me I have to run downhill and without falling over, yeah, that would make a lot more sense. But yeah, no. I think those are really, really interesting points. And yeah, another point, you know, we wanted to touch on a little bit is how does. So that's movement competency skill. How does physical literacy fit into this? That's another term sometimes I read. Is that the same thing? Or are we getting on to something different when people use that term?
It's used interchangeably, but it probably shouldn't be from where I would say. I'd say, and to be honest, like lots of terms, it's actually one that's just caused quite a lot of controversy and tension in the literature in recent years. So I think what everyone agrees on, to start there, what it appreciates is that movement skill learning or movement learning, movement competency, having high levels or well-developed movement skills is actually advantageous and supportive of other aspects of a child's development and their health and well-being going forward. So if you have a high level of movement skill, I don't like to say level, but if you have good movement skill, and you're then more likely to be more physically active, but also it perhaps benefits to other areas of your health and well-being as well. It's where everyone would kind of agree. And actually, the motor development field, I'll just pick up on it for a little bit longer, but the motor development field have done some really nice research to support this. So one thing they've kind of shown to us is that actually children who have higher movement skills do have better physical activity levels, not just when they're at that time, but actually tracked to later on. So when they are leaving secondary school, they still seem to be more active than children who didn't have those movement skills. In a society where sedentary lifestyles seem to be on the uptake, it's actually bucks that trend, which is quite important. Also to other, like academic achievement, people have started to see associations between that. Between other elements of cognition, these ideas of this executive function, et cetera, on children's self-esteem, perceived competence, these type of aspects, we're starting to see there is a relationship between those. Where the controversy comes in, it is actually where physical illiteracy came from and what it meant doesn't quite align to that assumptions, and it doesn't align to fundamental movement skills. It actually comes from the area of physical education. And physical education has a very rich historic academic literature in movement education and movement and like this embodied approach from like the philosophy of feminology, which really focuses on the importance of embodied movement. And so if I just pick up like physical literacy kind of like originally stemmed from here. When you look at Margaret Whitehead, who's the person who kind of came up with this physical literacy, and she came up with this, it's really interesting. I looked at one of her earlier quotes, especially her earlier work on it, which was quite aligned to this physical terminology. And the way she characterized movements or physical literacy, I'll just read you a little bit of it. Mm-hmm. It's, the characteristics of a physically literate individual are a person who moves with poise, economy, and confidence in a wide variety of physically challenging situations. In addition, for individuals perceptive in reading all aspects of a physical environment, anticipating movement needs or possibilities, and responding appropriately to these with intelligence and imagination. So it's a very rich understanding of what it means to move. And it's a very holistic approach, and it rejects this idea of dualism of mind and body being separate. that's actually a bit problematic when we start putting fundamental movement skills in with it. Because what we get is physical literacy, from Margaret's point of view, isn't so much about mastering specific skill sets as it's more about realizing an individual's potential to express themselves through movement. The consequence of this is movement shouldn't be seen as a skill set, but more as like the unique potential of that individual in their environment and in their context. And it can't work in absolute values then. We can't start comparing one child to another child and say, well, that child's skilled and that child's unskilled, because that kind of goes against the grain of what's an embodied understanding of what movement is. I guess another contention which has come in is people have taken on countries in response to these low level of movement skills and actually the increasing levels of sedentary. I've really listened to these rich explanations, which Margaret, descriptions of physical literacy. But then when it comes to actually the operationalizing of a practice, we see fundamental movement skills both in being taught these kind of narrow sets of skills. If you give children these to support them in other elements, but also then you're going to get, and they assess, so they assess children's physical literacy based on actually do they have these skills. So this is where I think some of the tension has come about.
Well, that makes a lot of sense to me. And yeah, I love that description, imagination and intelligence are not words you usually hear associated with this. But yeah, it reminds me a little bit of the performance learning paradox we kind of talk about in skill acquisition, right? You know, we have this pressure to focus on performance and getting things looking good now, measuring it now, where what we're trying to get is learning, which is improvement in the long run, which is messier and harder to measure.
I agree. It's something I've always struggled with as a working in physical education, but also it's like you can actually get a really good performance, but how you make it not episodic, so there's actually this kind of performance transitions into learning and that transition develop across these different time cells, how we can kind of connect these, it's a real challenge.
Yeah. No, I think it's really interesting. Yeah, the history of the PE is a really, the more I learn about it, it's more, you tend to think of it as really narrow, but then you have things like you describe and the games-based approach to coaching. There's a lot of great stuff that's come from it.
And there really is. Yeah.
So maybe if we can move on to, you know, kind of addressing these issues and some of the work you've done in that area. And I know the approach you've taken is looking to, as you mentioned, kind of motor learning research and ecological dynamics and non-linear approaches to addressing this issue. So I don't know if that's a good way to into that if you wanted to start talking
about it. Yeah. So, well, I actually set off when I first, kind of after my PhD, my PhD was very focused on fundamental movement skills, to be honest, and looking at how we measure and assess them and look at that. And then I, coming from a physical education background, I was like, no, I really want to get into the pedagogy angle and looking at this. And something actually, again, when you were just talking about some of the physical education literature, and they talk a lot about teaching styles or teaching spectrums and models-based practice. And they're really good, and I use them all the time. But then what I wanted to do with this project was to actually go, well, what happens if I take the theories of motor learning, and I took two, and go, well, let's look at those and then build the pedagogies or the way I'm going to teach around them. And actually that did something really for me. First of all, I was like, it shifted my perspective. So then, and something I see with my students all the time, they're so focused on them as being a good teacher. They're still working really hard on to support the children, but they're not thinking about how the children learn. So by actually focusing on motor learning theory, you flip it and you're automatically children learn. And then how should I develop my teaching based on that? And that was something which I guess really was interesting. And I went through this journey looking at two pedagogies, one based on more of an information processing and then one based on the ecological dynamics approach. They developed in quite different ways, really looking at ecological dynamics and this more non-linear approaches to teaching. I did find they offered me some really good key insights, which really did challenge my current philosophies and currently things I would teach in certain ways and adapt some different approaches. A good place to start will be fundamental movement skills, as we've been talking about for the last 20 minutes. If you were to then try to explain fundamental movement skills from an ecological dynamics rationale, and if we take that child doing that gallop, for instance, and what we see there, I think the example on the hill, it typifies what an ecological dynamics ridge would explain of how skills emerge. So the idea of this goal-directed movement of a product of interactions between the person, that individual, and their current capacities, structural, functional constraints, as they're called, their environment they're in, being on that hill, and the task of chasing their friend, meant that the emergence of was this kind of gallop. Because if they didn't, they'd have fallen over. It kind of shifted. You can still have the FMS, but it's kind of this more functional movement solutions. Mm-hmm. So what functional movement solutions is emerging from this? First of all, you start to realize this important role in which that environment and the way you're structuring those tasks play on the development of children's movement skills. Now, the difficulty is, how can you recreate in physical education this kind of exploratory kind of behavior of them intentionality, trying to get around to really engage in an environment which is going to see them moving in lots of different ways. Mm-hmm. And that's something which was really key for this project, was going, well, okay, how do we actually support children's movement skills, this development of emergence? We don't want to teach it to them direct, as you may in other approaches, but how do we actually allow these skills to emerge, but so they're functional and they're learning and not just actually playing? We're trying to work towards the development of movement competency, but this idea of it being emerging from interactions with their environment.
No, I think that makes a lot of sense. So can you give us a couple of examples of how you apply ecological dynamics to this in the kind of a PE setting like this?
It's a really important question, and it's something I'm continually working on, to be honest. And one is, I more look at what is physical education is. We're not trying to create performers of tomorrow. We're not trying to create your elite performers. What we're trying to do is make, and this is more of a physical literacy, enable children to be able to function, but get on well within their environment, their context, their surroundings, and to be able to live physically active and enjoy movement. But actually there's like, and when I look at ecological dynamics and how that kind of goes about that, I come to, there's some really exciting opportunities. And I remember a few weeks ago, I listened to one of your podcasts, you had Chris Button on from Otago. Really interesting work in water safety. Now, Chris, if we like to take Chris's, like think of physical education and swimming here in the UK, and I'm sure this is actually the same in many other countries, is something which is on the national curriculum. We should teach it, and children, all children by the time they leave primary school should be able to swim. That's one of the statutory requirements. But when we actually look at this in the UK, but one in three children by the time they leave primary school can't swim. Now, this isn't a fault of the PE teachers, and it's not really a fault of the school, and it's not a fault of the parents. Okay, for especially in these more deprived areas, to actually take a child to a swim bath here in the UK, it costs them about £4. And to actually go just for an experience, that's not a lesson, that's just for an experience like in the water. So if you're trying to think when a PE teacher wants to take a whole class, a whole year group to swimming, to teach them to swim, it's going to cost them a fortune, even with the subsidies. Mm-hmm. So, and then you've got to ask a question is, well, what's actually the goal? What are they trying to do? Are they trying to teach them to be the next Michael Phelps? The next Adam Peaty? Are they trying to teach them, get them these techniques which are going to enable them to go and form? And the answer is no, they're probably not. And what if you start thinking about looking at this problem as Chris does through an ecological dynamics, but applying it to PE? Is what we start to realize is that actually one thing is for a PE teacher to be aware of is, well, these drownings in the context they're happening, why we're teaching it, why it's on the curriculum, it's to stop children from drowning and be able to manage themselves in water. These are happening in open environments. These are happening in lakes, in rivers, in the sea. So is the environment, if we start to think from like affordances, ecological, is the best place to learn the skills in a tepid, warm, no currents in a swimming pool? And Chris's research would say no, because actually drowning is this kind of interaction between the child and the water. If we look at Chris's work, what it highlights to us is it says, well, actually, you don't need to take them on a 6-week swimming. But what you need to do is you need to take them for 2 days or 2 half days down to do these water safety skills in the context. And that will then tick off, but no, you've managed to support children So it allows us to start to really actually develop a PE curriculum that is individualized and supports the child within their context. And that's something I, because I'm pushing with like a lot of my students, it's going, well, let's look at some of these issues and then let's see if it can support it. And that's so an example like that. And then I just great one of my certain ecological dynamics in PE. Some of my students came up with this idea. Well, I said, look, let's teach creative dance. We want to teach this to the children. And they look at me talking to me and they're like, well, okay, well, if we're going to do that, we should involve it in the forest school. So what they do is they take the kids out once a week to this forest and they get to learn about nature. If you start doing the dance in that environment, what kind of dance emerges? What kind of things start to emerge, these more creative type of things? So it's kind of having that nuanced thinking. Again, gymnastics for teenage boys. Well, let's do it in a more urban environment. Do we end up with more parkour, which Keith and guys have done it? We start to see that actually the environment becomes a real teacher through these contexts. And I think that's something which we can do. And it's the more kind of environments we put children in around this, it's this more then exploration they're going to do naturally, the more re-specifying of movement. That would be from an ecological, like a very wide, if I'm planning a curriculum. So if I'm planning a term, a year, what do I want all these children to have by the end of the year? Well, these are kind of it. And so I'd be looking at context. Now, obviously, that those ideas are not always possible, but it does make us start thinking of it in a little bit of a different way.
No, I really like that. I like considering the why, you know, why are we teaching them this, you know, this skill and then the context. Yeah. And I know a really critical piece to this, and I know you've worked on, you mentioned it a bit earlier, is how we assess, right? If you're going to make big changes to a curriculum and then you're going to assess in the old way, right? You're probably not, it's probably not going to have much effect, right? If we're going to look for the same movement forms and things, but it's going to be problematic. So you've dealt more of a assessment based on creativity, right? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. Well, part of this, so the project was really, which we ran, is we ran across 12 schools. We looked at 3 schools had a more traditional based curriculum, which is fundamental skills, and they more rote learned them. So we taught them the skills and how they and do them through the teacher explaining, very didactic in kind of a nature. We had 3 schools which did an ecological approach, this more ecological, and we applied some of Jai Chow's nonlinear pedagogy principles to that. So the idea there was actually we looked at trying to create representative learning design. So the children didn't know it, but we would take these 5 or 6-year-olds, we would try to build environments which would support certain skills to emerge. So just a very quick example. In gymnastics, we would read a storybook called The Gruffalo. And we used Gruffalo because the children are used to reading it in their class and understand the story. But in each lesson, we'd meet a different character, if you're familiar with it. It's about a mouse. And he meets a different animal each week. And we kind of say, each week, we've set out all the equipment. It's always out. We don't teach any skills. But what we say to the children is, okay, you have a mouse moving through your wood. And we kind of build this story. And then we'll be like, well, okay, you've met the owl. And then what you'll start to see is when they're starting to play the games you've developed alongside this, it's kind of represents design, you'll see them start hopping onto the equipment, jumping on it, jumping between things, just because you've given them that analogy of something which is up in the ground. If I use the snake, they're more rolling, they're more crawling around the ground. So you start to see this, these kind of movement patterns emerging, which are themes of which we're trying. And then we apply other sorts of constraint manipulation. That's when they're, okay, we're actually, as a coach, moving around and trying to create little scenarios, change the equipment to enhance the movement we're seeing. So if they've got, say, some game, they've got to move a treasure from one side of their mat to the other, and the idea is you have to help Snake get the, sorry, it sounds ridiculous. You have to help the Snake get the treasure from one side of the mat, without it getting wet. The kids start doing different ways of rolling. Now, one may roll in this kind of shrunked up little ball, but actually what you want them to do is stretch out their arms and legs. So instead, you may give them a bigger ball, that means actually they can't physically roll over and they've got to try moving their hands in different. So you just get to explore the different movements and you just play around with that. And I guess the final key one is like trying to continually support this self-organization for an external attention and focus, mm-hmm. and how you ask the questioning and how you set up the task. You're not trying to get prescriptive and not too much. You're just trying to set challenges, set scenarios, set little mini games which have clear goals, which then they're working around. And then when you're seeing and when you're actually trying to make changes to their movement would be when you've just identified your, if the way you kind of go around the identification is if you're starting to do them seeing the same thing over and over, we see this kind of stabilization, that's when you want to come and kind of perturb it. Mm-hmm. Do you want to move this around a little bit? So anyway, I'll give you the context of the curriculum, which you're probably less familiar with. 6 schools carried on with their standard PE curriculum. We're very much still looking at the data, but the initial, based on the test you said, once it, because of a traditional, very didactic, we had the traditional FMS-based assessment we've always used. But then we looked at something called a divergent movement assessment. And for your viewers who are more used to reading sort of Dominic Orff's mm-hmm. research and looking at this kind of idea of how creative movement actions emerge from kind of exploration of the environment and their changing and manipulation. So I guess what we did is divergent movement is based on the work of Galliou and Cleland back in 1993. And what it is you assess the same skills, but you do it in a different way. So you create environments, basically. The locomotor environment, you set up an obstacle course, but they can go around it any way they want. There's certain equipment. And all we say to them is, we want you to move around this area in as many different ways as you can in 90 seconds. And what we're doing is just we're looking at their interactions with the environment and seeing what skills emerge. And can you show us another way? Is there a different way you could do that? So just giving them these kind of prompts, which aren't telling them what to do, but just trying to get them to keep exploring the environment. We are giving them little nudges, I guess, to explore. And what you start to see is really, if for every different movement pattern they show us, they get a point, a fluency point, that's a fluency. If they do the same pattern, but in a different way for interaction, they get a flexibility point. And we'll just keep scoring the children in such a manner of like looking. So how many different ways do they play with a ball? Okay, how do they explore? What do? They dribble it, throw it, kick it, do little tricks with it. And then the same moving around with your equipment. So we kind of have different stations, which kind of we're focusing on different skills. One would be more locomotor. One would be more object control. And then another would be more of these stability kind of skills. But you have to have the equipment in the environment to kind of, that. So that's what we did in the pre and post. And this is this idea of divergent movement. It's with looking for how these children interact and how the skills which come out of it from. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And so what did you, have you got any, you said it's ongoing. Have you have any initial findings?
No, we do have some initial findings. So based on some rough preliminary data. Yeah. Okay. So Rob, what we found was when we looked at this divergent movement and how the different groups have performed, overall, if we just looked at a whole divergent, all these scores put together, like all the different locomotor object scores all pulled into one, we found that there was both a time effect actually for all groups. They all improved over time. But then if we look at this in more detail, we find that pedagogy, non-linear pedagogy, had a marked, a significant effect over the linear and its traditional and the control schools who carried on with their normal practice. So that was interesting. And then what was also interesting, what we didn't really expect, is there was a time interaction or time effect for all groups on the traditional test, the test of gross motor. So we found they all improved just through this exposure of having 2 hours of PE a week. But we found the nonlinear improved even on this more technical assessment than the linear, the more traditional group who had learned these skills. So again, what's happening there is, I know it's more adaptive understanding, more attuned to the environment and what they're being asked to. We're starting to see them being able to cope and be able to show us better performances on these tests as well. So that was really interesting, this idea of importance of exploratory behaviour mm-hmm. in this learning process and giving the children to explore.
That's really interesting. Yeah, it is kind of surprising, that last finding in particular. And I can imagine, you know, obviously you're assessing probably enjoyment and engagement and things too. And just your description, it sounds so much fun.
It's been a huge amount of work, to be honest. I must mention, this is by no means, this is a huge effort, this project, mm-hmm. by 3 very impressive PhD students at the moment who are just coming to the end. I'll give them a little shout out. Katie, Fitton Davis, Matte Crotty and Laura O'Callaghan, who have really just been working on this. Now, they haven't focused on the pedagogy and they haven't actually focused on the movement skills. They've been focusing on, Katie's looking at how it impacts on like children's intrinsic motivation. So that kind of development of a love for being active. Laura's looked at more of a cognitive, how does these more exploratory engaging behaviours impact on their cognitive development, but also their academic achievement. Matteo's looked at more physical activity. So he kind of looked at these other elements of physical literacy to understand, well, does having these different approaches to pedagogy support these different areas? And this more embodied approach, I'd guess we end up with, similar to what Margaret talks about. There's lots to come, and it will be over many years, I'm sure. It's already been going on 3 years now. So, yeah,
we're getting...
But it takes a long time.
Yeah, it's a really impressive endeavor. Motor learning research is hard enough. Never mind doing a randomized control trial with about six different schools and different, you know, I can only imagine. Training studies are hard enough.
I'm not going to rush into any more, to be honest.
One thought I had in listening to you, and this is kind of thinking from the angle of the coaches and instructors that might be listening, whether it's you or the other people that are doing the nonlinear training, you know, it seems like it would be a skill that you really have to develop. Like you mentioned, stepping in when you see, you know, things stabilizing and knowing the constraints to add to destabilize it. And what's kind of your experience been with kind of developing your ability as a coach and instructor to implement these kind of things? I'm sure it's a really challenging thing.
It is. Yeah. And I think if you read the literature of like what Ian Renshaw's work and Jai's, they talk about the challenge of actually delivering this approach. Mm-hmm. And I think don't rush in to try to do it all well straight away. Like, I think actually the biggest things you can do is really think, I mean, your planning. It's around that planning side. So where can you kind of create these enriched environments through putting children in these different, like within your actual lesson? So don't think about your teaching straight away. Like, that's something which will develop over time, but you can probably have these more profound, bigger impacts on that, the planning of it. So how can I take a more ecological, what am I trying to do here? What's the function of which I'm trying to get to? And then what kind of environments can I create which are going to support that? And you start having those and then thinking about your actual planning your lesson. So then again, thinking about who are the children, what are these individual constraints? What happens if I put them in this activity and this environment? Like, trying to think a bit more about that around the interactions which are happening there. I would say that's the stuff which, especially at the start, and then once you get into that, for your teaching, you let that happen and you're observing this. Don't try to, sometimes it's so tempting. I think everyone we hear if I just tell you to do this, you do it and you pick it up and you go. It works, do it. It's fine, there's nothing wrong with it. But also, can the environment, and I guess this is talking from Katie's side of things, this intrinsic motivation, the reward someone gets from it, is there a way you can focus their attention to the environment which allows that kind of exploration and for them to get there by themselves? So is there a way you can structure it, you don't tell them what to do, but by manipulating, you know they're capable of doing it, can you focus them to an environment to support that?
That makes a lot of sense to me. And I think it's something also, I don't think we think about as a coach or instructor, the amount of time you have where you're actually live and coaching and teaching goes so fast and so small, right? Compared to the time when you could be designing, thinking about things, planning. So really, you know, that offline period, you know, taking advantage of that to think about why you're doing the things and being creative with, I think that's really good advice.
I think so. And I think it's that kind of offline, that planning we probably need to consider just as much, because to be honest, it just doesn't work. Nothing you try. I think actually a limitation where we try to actually plan the session itself, it almost is an impossible task. There's so many different degrees of freedom, which could go there. It can go in any way. If, in my instance, if Jeffrey's not had his breakfast and he comes in and he's wild and he just wants to be a pain, that could throw everything out the window. you've got to just be like, okay, well, I'm going to create this. And then as you go, and if you know your children, you know your athletes, you kind of work within that moment. I think that's that's kind of key for me. Yeah, it's almost sometimes if we're too ready, and what I mean, I guess, is if we're too ready to go, right, I must get this activity done, I must do it well, and then I'm going to move them all on to activity two by about 15-minute mark. I mean, I'm going to move them on to activity three. Well, actually, and I guess it's, and we were very keen on this more ecological approach, it's like, if they're learning and they're loving activity one and it's doing everything we want, all this exploratory behavior is happening, spend the lesson there. Mm-hmm. Because don't worry about them as a second activity. We can do that next time, or it just doesn't get done. Because actually what you're interested in is kind of exploration, respecifying, and lots of opportunities, repetition without repetition, all that sort of stuff, to doing the task. So if they're doing it and they're loving it, keep them there. And that's that kind of more in the moment, and something people often feel like, no, for a good lesson, I must take them through these different aspects.
Yeah. No, I think that's great advice. You're right. Letting it go and see, and also taking into account, the individual, if they're having a bad day or not receptive and things like that. And I guess the last question I have for you, James, I guess the top of this list is going to be finishing this huge study of yours, but what are kind of some of your future plans in this area?
I think it's working a lot, probably. I don't see myself running any RCTs or any more like this, to be honest, because I'd much prefer to work on smaller. One thing I do is every year I'll go in and I'll work alongside a teacher in a school, and I want to have more of a research focus on that kind of journey me and the teachers go on and focus. I'm also interested, I guess, I still come back to this measurement issue. And I do think, is there a way, at the moment we're seeing physical literacy turning into a very measurement focus, in that, well, what we need to do is we need to measure their movement skills, we've got to measure their psychological development through like maybe a questionnaire, and we've got to look at their cognition, and we look at these lots of different variables to try to understand the physical literacy. And I'm now come interested in some of Gibson's work of knowledge of the environment, so children now the knowledge, and I'm really interested to say, can we come up with more of this very quick test which more tries to understand that adaptive knowledge of the environment the child's in, because I think that could be a real supportive of trying to take the area forwards. But it also gives you accountability and lets teachers need to be able to do their planning based on something. So yeah, I guess it's carrying on this divergent movement research, but looking at it more of this holistically, physical literacy, of this knowledge of the environment. And I must say, like, I've been working a little bit with Keith on some of this, and Carl Woods as well. It's like, yeah, just incredible people to work with. So
yeah, that sounds great, James. And yeah, really interesting stuff. And as I said, I commend you on taking this big controlled trial on. I think it's really important to make these kind of direct comparisons. Yeah, this was great, James. Thanks for taking some time to talk with me.
Pleasure, Rob. Thank you so much.
Thanks again for the great discussion, James. Remember, you can contact me at robgray@asu.edu or follow me on Twitter at @shakyweights. To find out more about the podcast, please check out perceptionaction.com. Finally, to support the podcast and receive bonus materials, including written transcripts, please head over to patreon.com/perceptionaction. This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now, and keep them coupled. Straight away.